When we come together to light this flame, we remember Jesus. Fire is also a symbol of purification and of renewal. Let us be renewed in faith again today.
We breathe in and we arrive, grateful to be here. We come as we are, with our joys, our hopes, our burdens and our aches. We breathe in light and we breathe out peace. We breathe in love and we breathe out faith. We come to encounter the living God who calls us still. In life, in death, in life beyond death, we are not alone. Come, let us worship God.
Gracious and loving God, the love you show us through bread and cup strengthens us for the journey. Come and be with us today as we gather to worship you. You are the light for our path, the bread to our bellies, the living water that quenches our thirst. May this time together help us to recenter ourselves and encourage us to live as you call us to live in this world. Hold our mistakes and our misdeeds in your hands. Blow your breath upon them so that they may be removed from the weight of our living. Then, filled with your spirit and connected with our Christian siblings worldwide, we will serve you day by day. Amen.
Our first reading this morning is from Ephesians 5, verses 15 to 20. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and the hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our second reading this morning is from John 6, verses 51 to 58. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever.
I think it's a wonderful testament to my mother's care while growing up that now, as adults, my sisters and I all love to cook. We also are quite proficient at it. And while we use recipes and websites and cookbooks, we still create on our own quite a lot. And this is one of the ways that we share together in fellowship. We share our recipes. We cook when we get together. And the act of selecting food, preparing the meal, visiting while we are doing so, and then eating communally together is far more of a sacred task than it is a daily chore. Meals can be enriching, and they can also be healing. There was a cookbook I had until just recently. It was called Foods That Heal and Foods That Harm. And I collected it at a time when I was especially interested in preparing foods that were the most healthy and nutritious as possible for my body. So this cookbook was as much an instruction manual as anything else. It was all about the nutritional qualities of the different foods, how best to select them and prepare them to enhance those nutritional features, and likewise how to avoid the dietary elements that would be most unhealthy to take in. So I thought about that book this week while reflecting on what has been called Jesus' Bread of Life discourse. This is one of the passages that we know traditionally in the church as a source text for our communion liturgy. We remember Jesus telling the disciples that he is the bread of life, and that to eat of his bread is to eat of his body, and also that to drink of his cup of wine is to drink of his blood. But what was the context of those passages? Have you ever wondered whether the earliest Christians actually understood Jesus to have been instituting the ritual of the communion meal for the disciples in that narrated moment? In our scene today, Jesus and his disciples were in the synagogue in Capernaum with some of the other members of the priestly community, the frenemies, the Pharisees and Sadducees. And as was typical, the Pharisees and Sadducees were looking for ways to dominate Jesus with words, with trying to show him up to be misinformed, wrong-headed, or worse, even peddling in heresy or sinfulness. However, Jesus, as always, was a few steps ahead of the elite. He maintained his composure and meanwhile let the priest's words fall like toy arrows at his feet. And where they wanted to show Jesus in this case as disregarding the kosher dietary laws of their people, Jesus in turn showed them that their literal way of using the law and of using the law to fight and dominate with others was empty of meaningful content. For the Jews of Jesus' time also, the use of metaphor was actually a common feature of both public speech as well as of religious writings. So it wasn't that they were all literalists, that wasn't true. They understood metaphor and symbol and used it readily in many contexts. So although when we hear these phrases of John's passage today, we might wonder whether we should take them literally or not, it's good to remember that most likely Jesus' hearers at the time would not have expected him to be speaking literally. Jesus' words were powerful, there is no doubt. This is why he represented a threat to the chief priests and elders of his community, after all. Throughout the Gospels, Jesus is shown to use the traditional teachings of the Jewish people as well as the wisdom literature to cut through the priests' ways of wielding words as tools of power. Rather, Jesus tells us that the words he was offering were a teaching that was as nourishing as bread and as wine. This might have been revolutionary, and yet it wasn't, not really. The association of eating with taking in learning was relatively common in the wisdom literature of the Jewish people. It was found in texts such as Proverbs and the Psalms, the book of Sirach, even the prophets Jeremiah and Isaiah. So in Jeremiah 15:16, for example, the prophet says, "Your words were found and I ate them, and your words became to me a joy and the delight of my heart." And also in the book of Sirach, the poet writes that wisdom will feed with the bread of learning and give the water of wisdom to drink. There are all kinds of references to eating or drinking wisdom. So the Jews of Jesus' time, as we know from the collected writings studied from that period, they accepted that these metaphors, these poetic devices, were common in their text. We also know that table fellowship was a common practice. And not only table fellowship in terms of sharing particular things, which would have been beyond bread and wine, but that there would be a discourse element or a discourse stage of the social gathering that would happen after the meal itself. And before introducing that discourse period of the meal, there would be a libation, the pouring of liquid. And that would signal that it was time to move into this next stage, at the start of which all the members of the discussion that were seated around the table would take turns sipping unmixed wine from a common cup. So table fellowship was a time not just for enjoying community, but it was also a common time for the wisdom teachers of the day to share teachings with the students. So eating was an accepted metaphor for learning. Some have even called it a cognitive concept. Much like we have metaphors that we use all the time, and we don't even realize that we've taken that as such a metaphor that we use it in our unintended speech. The fight with cancer, for example, using war metaphors to talk about battling illness. It might come for some as a surprise to learn that the communion meal, as we understand it to be in the practice of the Eucharist, was not a part of the early Christian church until about the 3rd century after Jesus' life. Yes, meals were common, as I just explained, and we see them throughout the New Testament writings, but they were common in various cultures of the Middle East at that time, and especially so within the Greek cities. Even so, considering the historical context, considering the literary practices, those features do not diminish the power of Jesus' words as we hear them in this text. He is saying something very profound, and one of the oftenest words he uses, which alerts us to this fact, is to say truly. So in the Gospel of John, 7 times he says, "Very truly, I tell you." And he otherwise refers to truth or true some 55 times. All the commentaries would agree. Jesus is not abandoning the Jewish practice of relying on metaphor to make a point. One might say that he's using metaphor to appeal to something more true than a mere statement of fact. So just as we do when assessing the value of any words that we hear or that are proclaimed, we look first to assess the context, who is speaking, to which audience, and for what purpose. And if we include the parts that come before the text as well as that which comes after, we might take in any change of tone or any additional meaning and importance that might be given to what is said. And often we find that context does change these things. So let's think of an example. Think of all the toxic words that we come across in media. Think about when they're used to discredit a political opponent or some kind of competitor. Words taken out of context are featured all the time. Usually they're used to make a target look bad or incompetent, or even worse, to make them say something they never actually said, sometimes even the opposite of what they were saying. A video clip might be cut short, for example, to make it sound like someone supported an unpopular idea when they were advocating against it. Sometimes we also see words reduced to the point of ridicule. One example we could use was in the headlines just the other week: "Is she black or is she Indian?" Just a ridiculous attempt to create a distracting line of argument, putting the opponent on the back foot. The speaker knows that these words might have some power that might create for them some kind of advantage. These words are meant to harm the standing of the other, and watching them in context makes it obvious. Another factor affecting the truth of the words is their impact or their use. So the Pharisees' words, as we just saw, were meant to decrease Jesus' stature within the community. The chief priests wanted to harm his reputation, and they were shown frequently trying to get Jesus to admit that something he was trying to teach was actually against the law, or something he was doing was against the Torah. And later, during the Passion narrative, Pilate taunts Jesus, throws the word king at him, king of the Jews. In these and in other ways, Jesus brings our attention to the way that words can be used for violence. Still, we look at that deeper level of meaning in terms of the metaphorical meaning, the technical word that has been given to how Jesus' character in the Gospel of John uses that word truth, those 55 times, is a very, I'm not even going to use the word. We don't need to know what the word is, but it might be interesting and maybe even a little helpful to know that all this talk of truth for Jesus was on purpose, and it was meant to refer future readers to not look for a singular truth, but to a particular body of truth. In fact, to look for the truth of all the truths. Later again in the Passion narrative, when Jesus was speaking to Pilate, Jesus says, "For this reason I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." And Pilate answers him with his cynical scorn, "What is truth?" And a truth is delivered in that. Another little personal truth about me, I'm quite fond of yoga. There is a number of what they call ethical observances in the practice of yoga, and one of which is truthfulness. So the idea behind this concept of truthfulness is that one should speak nothing unless it is true, and even then, only if speaking it would truly help or be compassionate. This is not far from some of the wisdom sayings in the Bible. Now, if we were to imagine ourselves taking in the teaching of Jesus, of eating his everlasting bread of learning, of drinking in his living water of wisdom, how might that teaching change the way we speak? I suggest we would not argue as the chief priests and the elders had done. We would probably keep our silence a lot more. We would probably listen to hear more closely, looking for the hidden truths. And we might even say the words, "I'm sorry," or "I want to understand," more often. Ultimately, the truer words would be these than whatever we might have observed as mere facts and might have been thinking to say. So I think that what Jesus' examples in the Gospels teach and teach me is that it is always better to look for and to wait for words that might bring healing, and that practicing the way of Jesus as he was calling us to practice, to take in, is to continue to work very hard at disciplining against speaking words that will harm. Speaking for domination, speaking to discredit or to win. You know, I think cooking is probably a much easier practice. But also with practice, I do believe in the power of words to heal, just like good, wholesome, nutritious food. May it be so. Amen. generous and loving God. You feed your children. You care for all the earth. You dare to dream for a future for us that is filled with hope and justice. And yet, there are those who go hungry. There are parts of this world that are battered and bruised, torn and tormented. There are those who are imprisoned in despair. Help us, O God, to discern how to respond. Give us wise hearts and compassionate minds as we seek to pray, to serve, and to live well in these challenging times. Where there is conflict, may it cease and be still. Where there is poverty, may there be fullness. Where there is inequality, maltreatment, and transgression, may there be justice and compassion. May we all know your tending and empowering touch through the presence of your Spirit and through our work with you in making your dream come true here on earth as in heaven. This we pray, using the words of Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We go in God's continuing presence with the power to love and the strength to serve. Let us go forth in peace and be led out in joy. Amen.